Hello.
Hello.
Welcome to the Divine Truth Experience channel.
My name's Nicky.
My name's Perry.
And today, we're going to be talking about faith.
We like faith. Hi guys, welcome back. I hope you loved our little intro there. Me and Nicky found it hilarious expressing ourselves there. So, but welcome now. As you saw in the intro, we wanted to talk about faith today. So welcome to any new viewers, and for anyone who's seen the previous two, I hope you enjoyed those. And yeah, we will be a little bit more serious now as we introduce the topic. And what we would like to do today is share a bit of information on how our faith has grown personally with our relationship with God, and maybe demonstrate to you how initially that wasn't there and we had to engage in an experiment and go through a process. So just because I've been feeling lately that there might be a lot of people on the path or new to this idea and they're maybe struggling a little bit. Especially with things like, you know, if they hear things, you know, the words like Jesus and Mary or the word God, and, you know, that can bring up a lot of different emotions. So I know there's not a lot of people out there like sharing maybe what they've gone through with that concept and what that means to them personally. So Nicky and I have had some experience with that. And so today we just wanted to talk to you about some emotions that we've gone through that with ourselves and what's been helpful and what we've focused on and what we haven't focused on. And what kind of information we've maybe put on hold for a bit and just put, yeah, we don't know about that at the moment, but I just don't want to, you know, throw all the information away because that's important as well. And explain a little bit on how you can start to determine truth for yourself so you know what is true by using logic. And what that will prevent you will doing is it will help you stop just researching lots of different theories, and it will help you to start to determine some truths for yourself so you don't have to keep asking everyone. I know when I first started to do that, and still do now to varying degrees, I can get confused, really confused, and then start to feel like I'm being manipulated and all those things. So today we just wanted to share you our stories on our experiences on what we've done to kind of like cast out doubt and build our faith in the process that's happening. And hopefully this may, you know, inspire you to want to build your faith as well. So,
yep.
Anything to add, Nick?
So I'm Nicky, and like when you first kind of come across divine truth, usually you'll have very small faith in the actual process and stuff, just because obviously it's such a new thing. And when you first tune into any videos, you've got a guy saying he's Jesus, and then you've got a girl saying she's Mary Magdalene. So when you hear that, like with me, I just thought, whoa, this is crazy. Like these guys are saying they're Jesus or Mary Magdalene from the first century. And it's a bit of a funny one because, like, although you hear what they say and who they say they are, it's almost like you kind of put that to the back of your mind, in a way.
But you did.
Yeah, I did, yeah.
Yeah.
Just so that I could just listen to what they were saying and what they were presenting with an open heart and an open mind. Rather than always constantly thinking in my head, like, these guys can't be who they say they are, it's impossible. So that's what I kind of did at the start, and I just let myself watch the material and just let myself take it in. And then once I started feeling about the material that had been presented and logically looking at it and thinking, oh, actually, that does make a lot of sense. Started then thinking that I want to be putting it into practice, really, just to determine the efficacy of what they're saying and to determine whether it is actually all true and stuff. So there are certain processes you can go through to determine truth in anything, really. So that's what we're going to be explaining, really.
Yeah, I had the same. Basically, how I came across the teachings were, I had a desire to want to grow in love, and I'd been, you know, discovering and looking at other different spiritual practices. And I'd been looking at Jesus for a few months before I came across the seminars in different materials through a book called The Essene Gospels of Peace. I used to read a lot, which I found very interesting. And so I started to have a desire that I actually wanted to be like Jesus. I'm not saying I wanted to be Jesus. I felt like Jesus had some qualities that I wanted to have before I'd even met Jesus, just through reading different literature. And I think what happened was, through my desire to want to know that, shortly after, a friend of mine just sent me a video. It was the Secrets of the Universe seminar, which you can see on YouTube. So I highly recommend to watch that. So a friend of mine just inboxed me that, said one day, hey, just watch this, have an open mind, and see how you go. And so, because the fact that, you know, AJ said that he was Jesus didn't bother me that much, really, because I'd already been having previously this desire to want to be a little bit like Jesus in his character and stuff. So my first reaction wasn't just to dispel the whole thing because it was Jesus. For me, it intrigued me. I was like, wow, here's a guy saying he's Jesus. I'm feeling like I want to be like Jesus with my character and developing love. Let me listen, let me see what he's got to say. And I'm glad I did, because if I'd have just thought to myself, oh, here's another guy saying he's Jesus, and just thought, sack that.
Like one of those nutters again.
Yeah, I wouldn't have been able to listen to the information. So luckily, I don't know still the exact reason why I was still so open, but I'm glad that I was, because the information that was being presented just excited me so much and felt like it just resonated with my soul. This is kind of like a little in-joke with the divine love path, like you get, you know, the honeymoon period. So, and then your soul will start to sing when it hears truth. So initially, when I first heard the Secrets of the Universe, my soul was singing, and I was like, thank God, this is just what I've been wanting to hear all my life.
So much joy as you're just listening to this new material that you've never heard anywhere before. And you just listen to it and it all just feels so true, and your heart starts feeling the truth of it. Well, that's happened with both of us.
Yeah.
And we're both just like, oh my goodness, like what this guy's saying is just amazing. And it was almost like my heart level was just raised in the whole time I was watching it. So that's, I think that's what we mean when we talk about a soul singing.
Mm.
When, you know, your soul is just so open and it's just loving this stuff that's coming in, and it's like, oh, I want to know more, I want to find out more. How is this possible? How has this guy got to where he is through this process? So yeah, that's just a little bit of that. So
yeah, and I ended up watching there's about maybe like four different seminars you can watch, like 2-3 hours long, and I literally just watched them back to back. And what's funny is my experience, other people have the same experiences. You'll watch the seminars, you'll love it, and you'll think, yes, this is just the best thing I've ever felt and listened to in my life. And then what you've got to go and do is, you're so excited, you've got to go, oh, you don't have to, but you tend to want to go tell someone else, and then you'll explain what you've just seen, and then you'll go, yeah, but this guy says it's Jesus. Like, it's like you don't want to say that. Like, it's quite shameful to say, because you think people are going to think you're nutter.
Yeah.
So that was my experience. So I reckon most people who come across the material have the same experience. Like, they love the teachings, but then they don't want to say where it came from. And so you kind of shy away from that. And for what I was saying before, I wanted to kind of encourage people to do is, like, if there's any new people coming across this material, is try and not let the fact that Jesus is saying who he is, like, stop you from having an open mind and heart to what's being presented.
Like, it's important, though, that Jesus is saying who he is, though,
because
part of progressing towards God is the fact that you've always got to be, well, you want to be truthful at all times with whoever you're speaking to. So the fact that Jesus says he's Jesus is like just a fact of the way to God. And if you're not in truth with yourself and with others, your connection with God is like cut. It's cut because you're not in truth. And, you know, you almost, you know, let's say, for example, if, you know, Jesus was there and he didn't say who he was, he would be almost like holding that back, that part of himself back.
And it'd be fake.
Yeah, and it wouldn't be real.
And you'd feel that it was fake probably as well. You'd be like, someone's not quite right with this guy. That's what I feel. Anyway.
Yeah.
And then if it came out in the future, like imagine if he told you all these truths and all these seminars, and then right at the end, after months and years, he then said, oh, I'm Jesus. You'd be like,
it was all a waste of time. Yeah. And you'd be upset. You'd be, you know, angry probably. And that's what happens in general as well when you're not in truth with someone, mm-hmm. when you're not being truthful with someone, because you're almost leading them along.
Yeah.
Without giving them the full picture. And then at the end, you just drop a bomb on them.
Yeah. It's kind of like, if you've ever been in a relationship before, and then your partner's cheated on you, like you get that initial like anger and rage, you know.
Or just sadness.
And then you go to yourself, you go, oh, I've done this before. It's like, I'm not so bothered that you've cheated on me. It's the fact that you didn't tell me. And it's that mistruth or holding back truth that often gets us annoyed. And so the more that you're in truth, you just be more open and honest. So you can see why, and Jesus explains why he says who he is right from the start. And if you watch The Secrets of the Universe, there's a nice little intro there on all of that. Yeah. So,
and that's one of the things that actually drew me more to the material, because I was there thinking, you know, like if this guy is actually Jesus, what was resonating with me was, wow, this guy's got so much courage and faith that, you know, he can say who he is, knowing that 99.9% of people are going to completely, you know, mock him or disregard him, and, you know, all these other, you know, unpleasant feelings that you probably feel just because he's saying who he is. And also, if you think about it, in the first century, he had a lot of that treatment as well. Obviously, people not believing he was the Messiah and stuff. And so he's always kind of had that in both of his earth lives, I guess.
Yeah.
So, like, even in the first century, it was all about just listening to the message, listening to the teachings, rather than kind of just seeing him as the Messiah or Jesus. Like, as you progress and stuff over time, and you start building your own relationship with God, you'll begin to recognize who he is, and you'll be able to resolve that as time goes by.
Yeah, because I feel it's almost, I don't know if it's impossible for actually Jesus to prove who he is anyway to you or to anyone. And often what I find is when I'm trying to explain it to somebody else, I find it so hard to prove. And in the end, I just think, you know what, there's no point. So I'm at the point now where I can't prove it. You just got to like go through the process yourself.
Yeah.
And that's where the faith comes in. Like, you have to start yourself to do it, because you never, there's no amount of information, there's no amount of books, material, is going to prove that Jesus is Jesus and Mary is Mary and God exists and all that stuff. Like, it's, when we first get the information, it's all just theory, and you're never going to have a learning experience when it's just theory. You've literally got to go through it for yourself. So when everyone starts to ask me all the time, like, how do you know? But how do you know? But what if you've been fooled? And are you sure you're not naive? I say, like, well, no, because I've gone through the experience, and this is what I'm feeling.
Yeah.
And this is what I know to be true now. So. Yeah.
And also, you don't feel the need to even try and prove people anyway when you get to a certain point.
Yeah.
In your heart, when you know something, you don't even feel the need to get dragged into all of these debates with people and, you know, them saying, prove it, show me something, prove it.
Yeah.
And you're just like, no, like, I don't...
it feels weird, doesn't it?
Yeah, I don't need to prove it. I'm just telling you about it and then just leaving it in your own choice to do what you want with it. And then you can do that. Obviously, it'd be great if you do engage in the process and experiment and stuff. But to me, like, I feel my part of the task is to just introduce someone who is open and sincere to it, and then just leave it with them. And then if they've got questions, then I'm there. I'm always there. I'm open, like, for them to approach and to ask, to obviously help better their own understanding. So that's a really cool thing. And that's a bit of faith in there as well.
Yeah, it's also as you start to develop in love, you really start to become sensitive to free will, and you can start to feel the free will between individuals, and you can start to sense when a person wants to know the truth and when they don't want to know the truth. So kind of a lot of the times when I mention about the divine love or divine truth to someone, I can just feel like they just shut down straight away. Or if I mention Jesus and Mary, they'll just switch off, and I can just feel in their soul that they don't want to know. So I don't pursue it. I don't override their free will.
You don't try and force it on them.
No. And that's when I'll just stop the subject, and maybe in the future they'll come back to me and they'll say, oh, do you remember when we were speaking about this, which has happened, can you tell me a little bit more?
Hmm.
And then because they're engaged in their will, you can start to discuss the different subjects again. So,
yeah. So,
yeah.
So I guess going back to like the beginning,
faith, yeah.
It's like at the start, you're going to have very little faith, aren't you, really? Because, you know, you've not really felt anything as true as such, maybe, in terms of the processes that Jesus teaches and the principles. So you are coming into it with, like, no faith, essentially. And even, like, you do have to take just a step yourself, initially, some courage and bravery, just to experiment with one principle that Jesus teaches. So, for example, just trying to remain in truth with yourself and others as much as possible in, like, a day, and just try that as an experiment and see what emotions come up as a result of you trying that experiment. And so when you kind of start taking personal action and start taking personal responsibility for your own learning process, then you'll find yourself in certain situations and experiences where if you let yourself go through that, you come out of the end, like out of the other end, and you're like, oh, like that wasn't that bad actually. And you start feeling a bit more like joy and stuff, and a bit more faith in the actual process of being in truth, because you're thinking, oh, I can't say that to that person because, you know, they're going to be like this to me or like that to me.
Mm-hmm.
Usually you find if you're in truth with someone, they can feel that and they respect the truth that you're saying to them. Some people obviously, you know, may react like, you know, angry or condescending or whatever, which is fine, it's up to them, but you still feel you've done the right thing because you've still been truthful, and you feel that in your heart that you have done the right thing regardless of what they say back to you. So that's kind of one of the beginning points of building that initial seed and trust and that faith in the process.
Yeah, I'd just like to add on that also, one of the biggest things that grew my faith was first to learn and understand myself before I started to learn and try and understand anybody else. So I was, I would often, you know, want to believe other people. And I was scared of making my own choices, let me say it like that, through fear of making mistakes. In some other areas of my life, I had no fear of making mistakes. So in my physical world, for example, I had no fear in experimenting with my physical body in the gym and sports. So from an early age, I had a passion for sports. And would just, you know, I wasn't scared and engaged in any sport. And subsequently, I became quite good at all sports. I read all the material out there. And I had a very experimental way of being. So I was just saying to Nicky earlier, for example, you know, I'd read like a men's health magazine or something. And I'd see a picture of a guy who had the body that I thought that I would want, the six pack, the, you know, the chest. Like an athletic look, and then I'd look what he ate, and I'd look how he exercised, I'd look how much sleep he got, I'd look at how many times a week he trained, I'd look at when did he rest, all those things of how this person actually became to be an athlete. And so I had no fear in that at all. I just got off, I'd go, you know, I'd do the diet, I'd wake up early, I'd train hard, I'd work out every day, I'd go to bed early, I'd get the right nutrients, and slowly my body started to become like the guy in the picture. And I'd feel the way the text said about how the way this guy feels. So I was like, oh, if I did this and this and this, I actually end up being like this. So it was an experiment. Like, before I'd done that and took some action, I didn't know. I was just taking this guy's in the magazine's word for it. And I did it so much and so much and so much, and years after years and after years, that in the end, I just, my body was like that, and I had no fear in exercise and fitness, and now I'm quite knowledgeable about the physical body and how it works. So basically what I did, I just took that same principle and then applied it to my experiment with the divine love.
And, to spiritual stuff.
To spiritual stuff and Jesus. So I'm looking at Jesus and I'm feeling these things from him, and I'm going, I want to be like that. So if I engage all the things that he's saying, then logically I should end up with the same feelings and the same opinion as Jesus is explaining about the divine truth and God. And so that's what I had to do. But initially it was just theory. I was just watching the seminars. I was liking it and probably getting some benefit, but I wasn't putting it into action. And it wasn't only until I started to put stuff into action that I saw the results. Same as when I was in the gym. I could have just read the Men's Health magazine, or just read the articles, just looked at the pictures for months and months and months, and nothing would have happened to my body unless I actually took myself to the gym and did the exercises that it suggested. So, you know, that's how my faith started to build in this process, with divine truth and my relationship with God. So if you've just come across this and you're going, you know, and you've got loads of doubts, it's kind of understandable, really.
We both had them.
You're going to have the doubts because you actually haven't put anything into practice. So you will have doubts and you'll have all these questions. And, you know, seek the truth about them and use your logic and
experiment.
Yeah, and I think it's kind of like healthy to kind of doubt in a way, in the sense of getting to know yourself. And then you got to come up with your own answer from your own heart of what you feel about a certain thing. And then once you know, once you've gone through that experience, you'll know in your own heart, and nobody will be able to sway you. And you won't be saying, oh, this person said, or that person said, or Jesus said, and Mary said. You'll just be able to say it from your own heart, from your own experience, and it'll be way more powerful for yourself and for the other person who you're talking with, because they can feel from you that you've had that experience. So what I want to encourage is that you start the experiment, even if you've kind of like full of doubts and you've got no faith. You've got to start somewhere. So start where you're at and just engage the process and then see what happens and use it as an experiment.
Yeah, yeah. Like the thing that really got me at the start was when Jesus was describing from his own experiences about how amazing God is as a being. And that really struck a chord in my heart when, you know, Jesus was saying that, you know, God is a loving God. God wants the best for all of God's children, and God wants us all in our passions and desires and having the most enjoyment and bliss and whatnot. And the way Jesus was describing feeling God's love and feeling the inflowing of it, I was just there thinking, oh, I just really want to experience that if it's possible, just because if you know, God does exist and if God does have love, it must be the most overwhelming feeling to feel. So that's kind of one of the things that spurred me on and just trying to experiment with things. So, and I always kind of had that faith anyway in me that I felt if God was around and if God existed, that like God is good. You know, God wants all the, you know, good for us and he's trying to always guide us and stuff. So, So yeah, I'm quite lucky because I didn't really grow up in a specific religion as such, so I didn't get, you know, have many of these feelings in me that God might be a punishing God and stuff like that. And all of those feelings that you may have, they will prevent you from experimenting with divine truth and the principles that Jesus and Mary teach. So a lot of it initially is basically having your own faith to get through those feelings about God and to try and remove that, so you're in a place where you're open to receiving certain truths from God about how God is. So yeah, that's obviously a really, really, really important part of the process.
Yeah, and just like I was saying before, you will never know unless you start to engage the process yourself. So one of the main reasons why I want to share these videos and with Nicky is because we've gone through a certain amount of processes, and like we want to share that with everyone really, so they can have the courage and the faith to want to go through themselves. And so I suggest like watching a lot of the seminars presented already by Jesus and Mary, and just take it in. And even if you don't, you know, like believe who they are or anything, just kind of, you know, if you feel like you do want to change your life and how you are, even just from changing yourself and not including God, you know, there's plenty of materials on there that you can watch as well. So kind of like just watch the stuff, take it on like you would anything else. I like to put stuff into boxes as well. So some stuff I feel really sure about straight away. Some stuff I'm just like, nah, I can't believe that. And then there's other stuff where I'm like on the fence. And so I kind of like park it into three different boxes of what I'm going to do. So stuff that I feel quite sure about, I'll go off and do it straight away. Some of the stuff that I kind of, I'm not so sure about, or kind of, I think that's not applying to me, I don't totally disregard it. I'll just kind of leave it on the back burner for a bit. And then the stuff we're kind of in the middle where I'm on the fence, and I'll just kind of experiment. Normally the stuff that I don't want to look at and feels absolutely not for me is the stuff probably what's the most important. So I'm sure there's a material that I've been watching that I think I can't grasp at all. And it's probably because it's the most important thing. I think we leave the things that we're most scared of until last.
Yeah.
So we deal with all the stuff that we think we can handle first. And then eventually we'll get to a point.
As the faith builds.
As the faith builds and the courage. So like in the beginning, for example, like I was very scared to tell everyone the truth about how I was feeling. I was scared to tell about Jesus and Mary for good reasons. You know, I told my family first, and that didn't go down too well. So one of the fears was, you know, my family could disown me, and they a little bit did. So I had a fallout with my brother over it. He didn't speak to me for a year or two. Now we've just started to speak again. It's a lot more healthy. My mum went through kind of a bit of an emotional time with it, and still does a little bit. My dad, he was all right. I think I'm not sure how he kind of feels about it, but he doesn't really judge me too much. So that's just one area where I had to kind of speak up. And what's happened to me is the more and more I've been in truth and being truthful with people. And when I say in truth, what I mean is telling people how I'm feeling rather than hiding. When I say I'm in truth, it doesn't always mean I'm coming out with some universal kind of cosmic,
like with God's truth,
information.
Yeah.
I just mean like I'm just saying how I'm feeling to somebody else. If you often hear me say I'm in truth, that's what I mean. It means I was being honest with the person in front of me about how I was feeling. And initially, you never know how that person is going to react or how you're going to react to their reaction. So there's a lot of fears surrounding that. But over time, you'll have little experiments where you will then gain confidence in speaking truth and being open and honest. I can give you an example. Once I wasn't able to pay my rent, and I had some money on the way, but I didn't have it on the exact date. And I was really scared to tell my landlord that I didn't have the money. I tried to borrow the money from everywhere so that I didn't have to face this fear of telling my landlord that I didn't have the money. And the money, no one would lend them the money. And then I spoke to my dad, and he was like, I haven't got the money to lend you. You're just going to have to tell him that you can't pay the rent. And I was petrified at the thought of telling this person that I couldn't pay my rent. I thought I was going to get kicked out. I wasn't sure what he was going to feel about me. I thought he was going to think I was a loser. But so many different things that I didn't want to feel about myself because I couldn't pay that month's rent, even though I had the money coming in a few weeks' time. So there I was in my room, petrified. I was shaking. I was like, I've got to go tell my landlord. And he lived downstairs. So in the end, I plucked up the courage. I went downstairs and I told him that I couldn't pay the rent. And his reaction was not the reaction I was expecting at all. He was so calm. He just looked up from his desk, took off his glasses, and was like, yeah, no worries, Perry. He goes, I know you're good for it in a few weeks. It's like, just drop it into my account when you've got it. And I walked out the room like, ah, oh. I was so scared that he was going to go mental and angry at me. And he didn't. He just like showed compassion and was just like forgave me and was like, no worries, I know you can pay it when you can pay it. So my fear of saying to him how I was feeling and telling the truth about the situation actually didn't even happen.
And that probably would have come from a childhood experience you had, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Where you didn't feel like you feel you're getting into trouble for saying something that you feel that maybe like your mum or dad isn't going to like to hear.
Mm.
So probably like, probably stems from somewhere in childhood.
Yeah,
it?
Totally. So my dad would snap at me when I was a kid and stuff. I think he'll be the first to admit that. I don't mind saying that now. And so, you know, that's probably where I've picked it up. I've done something wrong as a kid. I get a little tap or shouted at to keep me in line. And so now as an adult, I have fear about stepping out of line. So, but what I did was I confronted that fear. I had a little courage. With my courage, I had an experience. And then from the experience, I had a loving outcome. And then so I had a little bit of faith in speaking truth. So all you've got to do is just do that, repeat that on every situation, all the time. And your faith will just increase so much quicker. So you can't not act. You've got to act without the faith, so to speak, but with courage. And eventually the faith will build. And then you'll have the confidence to live your life and be who you want to be all the time, expressing yourself in a loving way. So that's kind of how faith has been working out for myself.
Yeah. There's one really important thing that I'd love to say about faith, and that there's no such thing as blind faith. So we're not talking about faith like this wishy-washy thing where you're kind of just putting yourself out there and you just go, you know, going on a complete, you know, like living on a prayer, basically. It's like with real faith, it's based on facts. So 100% like provable experiences that you have in your life, you build faith from those. So when we talk about faith, we're not just talking about, we're not talking about things in the future that we hope may happen. Mm. It's stuff that, because we've gone through our previous experiences already, and we've seen that they have been true, and there's substance in what we've done and what we've experienced, it helps us then from there take part in other experiments and in other areas of our lives where we know if we take certain actions, then certain outcomes will ensue as a result. So true faith is always based on facts. So for example, Jesus says this a lot, but he talks about like gravity and the law of aerodynamics as well, and how the first people to have ever discovered anything, they initially went off... like they didn't just go off for like a blind faith initially. First they were looking at the logics behind certain stuff. So like the guys who invented like the first flying device, they didn't just, you know, go into the process thinking it wasn't possible. They kind of thought, you know what, like maybe we can create something that counters the law of gravity. So a higher physical law that when it's put into practice, it overrides the law of gravity. Not like the law of gravity just stops existing, because it's still there, obviously, but just another law supersedes it and stops the act of gravity acting in that certain regard. So in that example, the two guys who experimented with that process, they did go off logic initially, and they thought, okay, let's try experimenting with things. Let's try building something and seeing how it goes. And over time, and the more experiments they took part in, and the more modifications they then did,
refined
it, they then got to a point where, you know, they had like a 5-minute flight or something. And that's like, the process with God in everything, it's just having that initial kind of faith that something is possible, like better things are possible from nothing, basically. So if those guys didn't decide to take part in that experiment, it could have been hundreds of years, since another group of people decided to look at that and see if it was possible. And like, if you think about it, we've all got faith in that, like in terms of flight. Like, how many of us have got on a plane and have gone to a different country?
Mm.
We must have had some faith in that process and how it's possible to even step foot on a plane. So that can be related to God, like massively related to God. And if you follow certain principles of divine truth that Jesus and Mary teach, then for certain, certain outcomes will happen as a result. And it's really amazing, because the more you go through it, obviously, like, more faith will come to you, because you're like, oh, it's not too bad. And you get a lot of joy as well in the process. Like, when you go through something, you feel really good inside, and you can feel like more faith being added in your heart as you, like, developing and progressing. And particularly that's the case when you start really connecting with God and receiving God's love, because, like, the whole point of divine truth is building your own personal relationship with God, right? So when you have your first true experience with God and you realize God exists and God loves you and God wants the best for you and stuff, so, like, your faith increases, like multitudes when you have your first experience with God. And then you're just like, right, for example, for me, when I first received divine love, I got so much faith after that in the whole process. And I also got knowledge as well as a result of that experience.
And you also, what you can start to do is as well, if you've got your awareness, you'll lose your, as Nick was saying, you lose your logic, and you can start to map out what you're doing before your prayer, what you did whilst you were praying, how you're feeling, and then what the result was, and how did it make you feel. So once you've done that for the first time, and you go, okay, I did this, then I felt this, and then this happened, and then I felt God's love, you've got something tangible then to repeat again, like it's repeatable. So when another situation has happened, you can go through the same process, which will give you a bit more confidence and a bit more faith in the process. Then when you've done it 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 times, you'll have so much faith in your own ability to connect with God and feel God's love about a certain subject, or just to feel God's love. It'll just start to happen more often. And, and eventually the aim is that you're connected to God 24/7. So I'm definitely not there yet. So I've still got a lot of faith to build. I'm not saying, I'm absolutely full of faith 100%, because I'm not. But I'm much better off than where I used to be. And the little faith that I have got has propelled me in such a way where my desire increases to want to learn and discover more. And I know Nicky's experienced that as well.
I'd say you've probably got more than just a little bit of faith. Like, with your experiences, I think that's probably kind of putting yourself a bit, down in that. Because we've both gone through a lot of experiences where we're feeling extremely certain about things. And, like, I've got a tendency, like Perry as well, to kind of, like, almost play myself down with the experience I've had before. And that's an injury we both have and stuff. That's just something that
probably need to hear that. Yeah.
Yeah. For example, us even, starting to work on our, focus on our passions and desires. Once you start engaging in that process, you get even more faith with that. And then you start understanding more about yourself and understanding, I feel this is who I am, actually. Like, start feeling that that's who you are as a person and stuff. And with that, you get so much joy. Like, imagine if you, if God put in your soul, when God created your soul, that you had this a gift with dancing, let's say, and then your whole life, because you might have been shut down to dancing based on certain injuries you've imbibed from your parents or your environment when you were younger, you've been completely shut down to that. But let's say, you know, through your life, you've still had this kind of feeling, like, and had this interest somewhere in your heart deep down with dancing, and you've been intrigued by people dancing, and you've seen dancing on TV, and you feel your heart raise a little bit when you see it. And then imagine if you connect with God, and then you do receive a feeling from God, a truth from God saying that, yes, you do have a gift with dancing. So when that happens, because that did happen with me, it was in music, that I never knew was part of me. But like, that can happen in obviously loads of different areas, depending on the gifts that you've got in your soul. And once you obviously get to a point where you recognize it, you're like, wow. And you start, you know, experimenting with it. You might get yourself some dancing shoes or go to dance classes. And you start engaging in that process, and you get so much happiness and joy as you're going through the process. Like, there could be points, obviously, at the start when you're not that good and you've got these frustrations and whatnot. Like, I know for me, definitely, when I received the truth from God that I've got a gift with music, I went and bought myself a guitar. Because I was like, right, okay, God's told me this. I've got a faith in that, and just try it out. And at the start, I was just so frustrated when I tried learning guitar. It was just the most frustrating thing, and I realised it was because of certain injuries I've got in me from my childhood that prevented me from, you know, learning new things. And, you know, I felt like my hands just weren't the right shape, like my fingers weren't the right shape to move on the chords and stuff. And like, I just felt I had no rhythm in my strumming and stuff. So, like, with that, you've also got to remain in a space of, like, humility to the feelings that come up. And if you let yourself feel those feelings or frustrations or whatever it may be, and you let yourself go through that emotion, you'll find some sadness underneath, usually. And if you let yourself feel that sadness, you know, let's say 2 days after, you think, oh, I want to play guitar again, and you feel like it's more natural to you after that, you feel, oh, like, yeah, actually.
So, well, what would have happened, Nicky, if you got to that frustration and then just jacked it in?
Yeah.
What would have happened? Like, you would have...
I wouldn't have...
Played.
Yeah, I wouldn't have played. I would have given up there and then. Yeah. But I had the faith because God told, like, God gave me that truth, partly because I always asked for it. I didn't really ask for it. It was like a secondary thing that God wanted to give me, that God knew that I'd have really enjoyed to know and stuff.
And also, I often look at stuff. So, Nick is playing the guitar. I've seen other people play the guitar, like loads of people can play the guitar, so it's obviously a human being can play a guitar. So there's Nicky who can't play the guitar. He can look at others and go, well, if we're all equal and we've all been created by the same source, surely I must be able to play the guitar. It's only something in him that's preventing him from playing the guitar.
Yeah, it's true. Yeah.
You know, because it's been proven that many other people have. And that's what I love about my relationship with Jesus and learning from Jesus, is that I'm looking at this guy going, well, it can be done, because here's a guy showing me it can be done.
Yeah.
It's only me, just because I'm not there yet, doesn't mean to say it's not possible. It's just me not there yet, that's all. And I've got some processes to go through.
Mm.
So I haven't just jacked the whole thing off just because I'm we're gone yet, because then I would never get to God.
Yeah.
It's not going to happen, you know, overnight. And I think a lot of people
don't want that,
jack stuff in straight away because it's not an instant fix. They haven't got the
one that instant gratification.
The patience. Yeah, they haven't got the patience to carry on through. So my patience has been tested through this. And my patience will grow, and my love for myself will grow, because obviously, you know, before I used to beat myself up because I wasn't growing quick enough. So through the process, you learn
so many
things. You learn so much more things about yourself through having a desire to want to get to God. So it's quite amazing, the design, really. Because as you grow closer to God, many different things happen. And one of them is you learn about yourself and you come to know and love yourself. The other one would be you'll come to grow and learn and love your soulmate, the other half of yourself. And in that process, you'll come to know and love God. And you'll also just have this love for everyone else. So, you know, it's when I see that happening, for example, when Jesus and Mary and witnessing their lives, it's really encouraging for me not to give up. I could have given up, and if I did, you know, I'm just preventing and stunting my own growth.
And your own happiness.
And my own happiness. And I don't want to stay in that unhappiness place. I've got this feeling that there is joy out there that I can achieve. And, you know, I just want to keep moving forward with it. So I don't let my upsets keep me down. They might keep me down for a bit, but then I'll work through something, I'll learn something, and then I'll move forward. So, and I think I've just come to accept now that's just the way it's going to be until I'm at one with God. There's going to be frustrations and down times and times when I want to give up. But I don't, you know, and I've got my friends around me now who can encourage, and you've got God there who you can always rely upon, even if there was no friends around. But that wasn't the case in the beginning, you know. I need a little bit more help and some more guidance. But over time, through my experience, my faith has built. And eventually, you know, I won't need anyone's help. I'll just have a desire for God and want to love God. And, I predict that will be the way for me. And friends and stuff like that will just be, you know, a benefit of... friends with benefits.
Not in that kind of way.
Yeah. That's my sense of humour today coming through, as you saw earlier. But yeah, all these things become added to you. I can't say enough. I say it, I think, in all the videos. You know, seek first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added. And that phrase is just becoming more and more true to me. And it's amazing when you see it start working in your life. So
yeah, it's really cool. Like. For me, and I'm sure it's the same with you as well, but like when you look at the older Divine Truth videos and you see how Jesus and Mary were in those videos, and then you now look at them in the most recent ones and you see how much they've changed, particularly Mary, because Jesus went through a lot of his own stuff before he started, you know, going
off camera.
He went through his own stuff before he started teaching again and whatnot. So we still see how Jesus has progressed if you're more sensitive to that. But with Mary, there's like massive, you can feel and see there's such a change in how she was in the early videos to how she is now. And that also gave me so much more faith in it, seeing Mary going through her own things whilst on camera as well. Like, that's a really, you know, brave and courageous thing to do, and I know it's helped me so much by seeing that and stuff, and then seeing Jesus like helping her through it at the same time and giving her advice and support and always reminding her of like the truth of certain things, mm-hmm. even when she might not like feel it in the heart yet. I feel that's a really important part of the whole process, and you can definitely build a lot of faith and inspiration from like Mary's example. So I've got so much, like in our intro video, I said how much love I've got for Jesus and Mary. Like, so much, just seeing, like, just them being who they are and having that courage to teach. And with Mary, you know, going through her emotions and stuff in front of everyone, in front of camera, you know, in front of the camera and stuff, it's just so inspirational. And mm-hmm. that's why we have so much love for them. And I find it a bit funny how, you know, not many people like feel like
trust
love
them. Yeah.
Yeah, they don't trust them. They don't feel like love for them and stuff. And they get usually, you know, a lot of condescension and anger and all these other feelings, and I'm just there thinking, wow, like,
yeah. And if you actually, you know, obviously some of people watching may not have met them or seen them before, and once you do, there's no way, you know, they're gonna start to get us to do stuff that's unloving, like in this cult. start to think. I mean, if you think about the whole process of what we're trying to teach here, is that you start to become, you start to know yourself, and you become so sure of yourself, and you become sure of what love is. There's no way someone would be, like, for example, if Jesus or AJ, whatever you want to call, you know, by his name, was to come to me tomorrow and say, "Hey, Perry, I've got this ritual going on tomorrow, and you got to do this, and you got to drink this poison, and you got to, you know, kill yourself for God." You know, I would now turn around to Jesus and say, "Are you mad?" Like, if he said something that to me, you know, it's because I know what you know. I've got a feeling of what love and truth is, so I can't be manipulated by this cult leader, because I've got a good sense of what truth and love is, and I wouldn't do that to myself. All these things that you would hear, you know, about what a cult leader or what Jesus is and all these things, they're all just fear. He's actually teaching about truth and love and how you can determine truth and love for yourself. And that's become more prominent in my life as I'm learning about truth and love. So, you know, you get often a lot of people saying, "Oh, you're so naive to you know, believe all this stuff." But what's happening is my own faith in myself and in the process becomes so strong, you know, even if Jesus was a cult leader and was, you know, planning to bring doom to all his teachings and wanted to do all these things, I just wouldn't do it because I know what's loving and what's not loving. And I know, you know, from engaging with Jesus, towards them, they're not going to do that. But, you know, if you don't know them, you might have those fears and stuff. But
yeah, a lot of people do have those fears, don't they?
So, and we can't take those fears away from you. It's, you know, at some point, you're going to have to trust either Jesus and Mary, me or Nicky, or someone else who's talking about these teachings. You're going to have to take the first step sooner or later, or never, which I don't think will happen. I think it will. Your life will get too painful for you in the future that you will try anything.
We've all got free will, haven't we? Mm. So, you know, no one on the divine love path is going to force anything on you.
Yeah.
Someone who's truly on it, because the whole point of it is to grow in a relationship with God so that you get to a point where you act in situations how God would act. And God gave us all the gift of free will. God respects all of our free will, so God doesn't even force God onto you.
Mm-hmm.
It's all about, you know, your own free will and what you desire to do and where you want to be in your life. So, you know, we're not going to... we've got absolutely no investment in you guys listening to what we're saying. Like, we don't care if you think we're mad. We're just presenting what our own experiences, what we've known for facts are true, and we're just putting it out there. And if you guys are interested, then amazing. And there are many people who probably would be able to help you. You've got tons of spirits there, like spirits on the Divine Love Path. People have died who are always there trying to help us and try and lead us to God. So there's so much help available and so many ways God can bring us to God if that's what we desire. And obviously that's what God really desires as well. Like, one of the reasons why God created us is so that God could give us God's love and for us to experience how amazing that is. And also, you know, God would really enjoy receiving love from God's children. Like, imagine if, you know, you've got kids and whatnot. You know, you want to give them your love and you want them to feel that. But also, you know, it must feel nice if your kid expresses their love towards you as well. Like, I don't have any kids and Perry doesn't have any kids either, so we don't kind of have that experience. But I'm sure the people who do have kids can feel that is true in that sense. And God's just like the parent of all of us. So surely that can be applied to God. From a logical perspective, surely that makes sense. So I feel that's an important thing to understand, really.
Yeah, I think, I don't know if there's much.
I'm thinking, oh yeah, like one other thing, like people who are on the Divine Love Path now are almost in a way acting on faith, because they haven't seen anyone yet getting to a point of at one moment with God in this,
yeah,
like in our lives right now on earth. Like Jesus was at one with God in the first century and whatnot, but now at the moment, no one is at one with God again yet. So until the first person gets to that condition, it's almost like you are acting on faith and your own experiences and wanting to take part in the experiment. Well, then let's say Jesus or whoever else who's already been on the path for a while and progressing on it, let's say they get to that condition. Imagine how much faith that will bring,
yeah,
in other people who witness it and see the condition for the, you know, in front of their very own eyes and see that it is possible and seeing that that is the way to do it. So you could just be like, oh, well, you know, I'm just going to wait around and just carry on with my life. And, you know, if it's possible, I'll just, you know, I'll let whoever go through the process first. And then when they prove it to me, then that's when I'm going to take it seriously.
Yeah.
Whereas that's not real faith anyway. Like the people who are progressing on the path already, they're going to like, and they get to a certain condition of love, they will, like, I've got faith that we will have our own joy and experiences and pleasures as a result of us having the faith to progress on it before, you know, the first person's got to that condition.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, that's a great thing with God, is how anytime you're acting on with God's truth and love, you get all these amazing benefits that you don't even realise are possible.
Yeah, and I think, you know, if you just wait for someone else to get there first, you're just delaying your own joy and pleasure. So you could, like, think, you know, wait to see it proven, but, you know, why do that? Why not prove it for yourself? There's only a fear, I believe, that you think that you can't be the person who can be there first, you know. I think I've maybe heard Jesus say, any one of us could become at one with God before Jesus. You know, Jesus is no one, you know, special, like, is just another human being, another, you know, our brother and sister, is no more superior than we are. It's just a case of desire, and at the moment, you know, it seems Jesus and Mary
desire the strongest,
just desire it the most, but it doesn't mean to say that any one of us, you know, can't have that same desire and passion for connecting with God. So there's no time. You don't have to delay the process. Just as an analogy from another physical point of view, it's the first person when they, you know, they broke the minute mile in the running. No, not
Oh, minute. It was a 4-minute mile.
4-minute mile. I can't remember the name of the
Roger
guy.
Roger Bannister.
Was it Roger Bannister? Yeah.
Yeah.
So as soon as he did it, then everyone else started to break that.
Yeah, just everyone, wasn't it? Because no one thought it was possible.
It was impossible. And then everyone, you know,
when they saw one person did it, yeah, then everyone started doing it. Yeah, that's a really good example, actually, mate.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's really good.
So, yeah.
Yeah, I think that's about it.
I think
it,
that's
yeah,
all there is to say. Obviously, check out Jesus and Mary's
yeah,
YouTube seminars. There's a lot more information on faith and building faith. Ton of information on there. So you can go on YouTube or the www.divinetruth.com. On YouTube, it is the Divine Truth channel. And you can also visit, you know, www.divinetruthhub for interactions and go on the forum. And Nicky often posts different things on there to direct you to certain bits of information.
And other people as well.
Yeah,
right?
You can email us and ask any questions. And, you know, if we can, we will. And if we can't, maybe steer you in the right direction. So plenty of opportunities. And if you want to learn more, you can subscribe to our channel and you will see the videos appear when they appear. And yeah, this is us in our passions and in our discovery towards God. And yeah, you know, we're doing this anyway, so obviously it's encouraging for us, and we just want people to, you know, do their own thing as well. And you know, we feel if you involve God in that process, things will just be amazing in your life. So I hope you enjoy it. I hope you
find it beneficial.
Yeah, find it beneficial is what was the words I was looking for.
Yeah.
And yeah, we'll see you next time when we introduce our next topic. Thanks for watching.
Yeah, cheers, guys.
Bye-bye.
Take care. Hi there, everybody.
Hi there. Do you know what it is and what cracked me up with you?
When I wave.
You're a Martian. And we need that voice before.
Maybe I just won't put my hand up.